great to have everybody with us this morning. You can be seated. Sorry. Sometimes sitting down helps people to concentrate on what's important. So we have three really important things. One is the blessing of the backpacks. Sunday, August 15th, which is two Sundays from now, at 11 o'clock contemporary worship, Reverend George will be doing the blessing of the backpacks. So come and bring your backpack or your laptop bag or whatever and have it blessed. The new First Church staff are Miss Rhonda Singleton. She is now our part-time volunteer coordinator. And also, Miss Yvonne Britton is our part-time children's director. And Miss Julia Brooks is now working at the First Church Academy. So we are really excited to have these three positions, and thank you. And finally, the First Church Academy's open house is August 9th, which is a week from tomorrow, from 5 to 7. And everybody can come. We invite you to come and to see the lower part of the Wesley building, which has been remodeled, where our First Church Academy will be housed. And they are having a book drive. The Academy needs new and used books, and you can leave them in the Narthex, which is right out here, or in the Wesley Worship Center entrance. So thank you so much for those contributions, and we look forward to having fellowship and fun here at First Church.
If you'll rise and join me with our affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For us to center ourselves for worship this morning, for our experience with God, because that's what it's all about. It's about being here together and experiencing God. So let's go together in prayer. Father God, thank you so much for the gift of this day and for the gifts that we receive that we don't even know that we're receiving. God, I just pray that you would be with us during our time of worship together, that we would experience you in new and exciting ways, that we would hear a message, whether it's in the sermon or in one of the songs, that we would hear the message you have for us today. God, there is so much going on in our world. COVID's coming back. We have people who are dealing with health issues, who are recovering from surgeries, who are getting ready for surgeries. And we just ask that you would be in all of that. We trust that you already are. And God, I just pray that your will be done in all those situations, and that if there are things that we need to do to help, that you would stir our hearts to rise up and be a help. God, we are thankful for all that you do for us. We are thankful today that our eyes are open and we're worshiping with one another, with our family. Just ask that you'd be with us and that you would guide us in all that we do and that we would feel you in big ways as we pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to ask our ushers to come down, and as they're coming down, it's time to find your pocketbooks and your wallets and give to the church so that we can do the missions that we are called to do as believers. For these gifts, and we ask that we would use them to your will, and that you would bless them and multiply them in many, many ways. Amen. As our children come down for Miss Julia's sermon, boy, I can't think right now, because I was just so blown away to look up in the balcony and see this child, Bella, coming down right now, who helped her dad do the offering. Train them young, friends, train them young, and they'll be around for a long time.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good. I have a question for you. You ready? Is it fair that if you sinned or did something you shouldn't do, that you get punished for it?
Do you think it's fair? You might not want to admit it, but it's kind of fair, right? Yeah.
Well, when we do something that we shouldn't do, we have consequences, right? We still have to pay for the consequences, right? Because we decided to do it. God might not be happy that we sinned, right? No, not necessarily. But he still forgives us, right? We have to pay the consequences, but he still forgives us for our sins. Well, in the Bible, there's a man named David, and he admitted that he sinned. He still had consequences like we do when we do something that we do that we shouldn't do, right? But still do it anyways? Yeah. We've all been there, right? Well, he had to pay his consequences too, but God was with him the whole time, just like he's with us the whole time. And he forgave him for his sins. All we have to do is pray to God and ask for forgiveness of our sins, right? So just remember that. Can we bow our heads and say a prayer? All right. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to face our consequences, even when we don't want to. And help us to ask for your forgiveness of sins. And all God's children say, amen.
Today's scripture comes from 2 Samuel, chapter 12, verses 1 through 7. And the Lord sent Nathan to David. He came to him and said to him, "There were two men in a certain city. The one was rich and the other poor. The rich man had many flocks and many herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought. He brought it up and grew it up with him and with his children. It used to eat of his meager fare and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom. And it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. So he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come to him. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, 'As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity.' Nathan said to David, 'You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul.' This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God."
Thank you. despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned.
That was beautiful. The seven deadly sins are lust, gluttony, greed, sloth, wrath, envy, and pride. In today's story of King David and Nathan, we see the veil being torn off of David's actions and desires to reveal his sinful nature. It must be said that underneath David's sinful nature is our sinful nature, because we are just like King David in our lust, our greed, and our pride. All of the definitions are from a Google search. Lust is a very strong sexual desire. It didn't take much to get King David's heart racing when he saw Bathsheba bathing on the roof. In his song, Hallelujah, Leonard Cohen wrote, "Your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof. Her beauty and the moonlight overthrew her." We see in chapter 11 of 2 Samuel, one evening David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful, and David sent someone to find out about her. The man said, "Isn't this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" Then David sent messengers to get her. She came to him and he slept with her. From the moment he sent the messenger, he didn't care if Bathsheba was Uriah's wife. David's lust took over his senses. David's lust came between his better judgment. David's lust overcame his obedience to God. Greed is intense and selfish desire for something, especially wealth, power, or food. David wanted Bathsheba. After she slept with him, she went back home. The woman conceived and sent word to David saying, "I am pregnant." David was trying to think quickly. He knew he had done something incredibly wrong, and he was trying to make it right. In desperation, David sent this word to Joab, "Send me Uriah the Hittite." And Joab sent him to David. When Uriah came to him, David asked him how Joab was, how the soldiers were, and how the war was going. Then David said to Uriah, "Go down to your house and wash your feet." So Uriah left the palace, and a gift from the king was sent after him. But Uriah slept at the entrance to the palace with all of his master's servants and did not go down to his house. When David was told Uriah did not go home, he asked Uriah, "Haven't you just come from a distance? Why didn't you go home?" Uriah said to David, "The ark and Israel and Judah are staying in tents, and my master Joab and my lord's men are kept in the open fields. How could I go to my house and eat and drink and lie with my wife? As surely as you live, I will do no such thing." Uriah is a loyal man. He is an honorable man. He's staying in solidarity with his men and his leader. David wants to cover up Bathsheba's pregnancy, and Uriah will not lay with Bathsheba out of respect for his lord and the other men. If Uriah doesn't sleep with his wife, he will know the baby is not his. David tried to get Uriah to sleep with Bathsheba, but it was useless. So David concocted a plan to have Uriah killed. David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it with Uriah. In it, he wrote, "Put Uriah in the front line where the fighting is fiercest, then withdraw from him so he will be struck down and die." David's greed, his intense, selfish desire to cover up his actions, led to Uriah getting killed. Uriah the Hittite died. When Bathsheba heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. After the time of mourning was over, David had her brought to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing David had done displeased the Lord. David's greed to hide what he did with Bathsheba led to the murder of Uriah. Though Uriah died at the hand of someone in battle, it was David who was responsible for Uriah's death. David's greed led to Bathsheba being pregnant, Uriah's death, and Bathsheba becoming his wife. David's greed overcame his obedience to God. Pride is a feeling of deep pleasure or satisfaction derived from one's own achievements. At the point of bringing Bathsheba to his house and Bathsheba bearing his son, David must have felt some safety in covering up his scheme. His pride was getting the best of him. But Nathan was sent to David by the Lord, and Nathan helped to open David's eyes to what he had done in the sight of the Lord. The story that Nathan tells about the rich man with many sheep and cattle and the poor man with one ewe lamb is an allegory to David as the rich man and Uriah as the poor man. David had access to many women. Uriah only had Bathsheba. David was king. Uriah was a military man fighting for a cause that he believed in. Bathsheba is the ewe lamb. She is an innocent whose life is never the same after King David has his way with her. His power and his desires change the course of her life forever. Nathan said, "But the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him. Upon hearing this, David thought it was an actual account of something that had happened in his kingdom between a rich man and a poor man. He was taking what Nathan said at face value. David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die." David said that. The man who did this deserves to die. He must pay for the lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity. Then Nathan said to David, "You are the man." This is what the Lord God of Israel says. "I anointed you, David, king of over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. David, I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I gave you the house of Israel and Judah, David. And if all of this had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? David, you struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house, because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own." David's pride had gotten the best of him. Nathan said to David, "This is what the Lord says. Out of your own household, I am going to bring calamity upon you. Before your very eyes, I will take your wives and give them to one who is close to you, and he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. You did it in secret, but I will do this thing in broad daylight before all of Israel." David, after Nathan's story, had finally had his eyes opened to his own sin, and he finally exclaims, "I have sinned against the Lord." But David's pride caused him to be blind to all of his madness prior to this moment. How is it that in all of David's deception, he was not aware of his own madness until Nathan told him of the consequences of his actions? So often, this is where pride leads us, to a consequence that we cannot escape from. David's decree about the rich man taking the poor man's ewe lamb was that the man should die. Nathan's reply to David after he realizes his sin is, "The Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die. But because by doing this, you made the enemies of the Lord show utter contempt, the son born to you will die." So there are consequences to our sins. There are consequences for our sins against other people and against God. Even though we are forgiven our sins, we live with the guilt, the consequences, and the stain of our sin before God and before man. David's pride overcame his obedience to God. It is a sin to put our desires above God. Sins start out so innocently. David saw Bathsheba bathing on a roof, and it led to his whole life falling apart. David's lust, David's greed, and David's pride got in the way of his relationship with God, and his life took a drastic turn. Can you live with a turn like that in your life? Are you afraid of God? Are you respectful of God in the sense that you respect God enough to try to do the right things? Because we all know what it's like to live with the consequences of our actions. God may forgive us, of our sins, but we do have to live with the fallout. Friends, I believe that this scripture is calling us back to accountability in all areas of our lives. When we look at King David, we have a lot to consider. David is a king. Who calls him to accountability? No one. King David is not accountable to anybody but God. Nathan wakes David up from his sinful nature, but what is done is done. David is the man, and so are we. If we do not want to get into difficult situations in this life, we have to hold ourselves accountable. We have to keep ourselves in check. The best way that I know how to do this is to be a part of an active faith community in corporate worship, gathered with the body of believers, and in singular worship, every day of the week, doing devotions to God, praying to God, keeping yourself in check. And to keep our relationship with God open and honest. David's sinful nature and ours is rooted in disobedience to God, putting our desires above our worship of God. Anytime that we do something wrong, we are in essence turning our backs on God. God forgave David, but there were consequences. What will our consequences be? David's first son with Bathsheba died. David's son Amnon raped his sister Tamar. Because Amnon raped Tamar, Amnon was murdered by his brother Absalom. All of these tragedies came from David's original sins of lust, greed, and pride. We are also capable of these same sins, and we can keep ourselves away from them if we are mindful of placing our relationship with God above all others. Today's scripture calls us to sincere self-reflection. Today's scripture calls us to self-denial. We must realize that our own sin is always what separates us from God. Remember the fall of man in Genesis? Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die." "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good from evil." Choose good over evil. In your heart, you know the difference. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for the scripture in 2 Samuel of David and his life. Help us to examine David as a man after God's own heart, and help us to see David as a reflection of ourselves. Help us to have the right things in mind, to consider good over evil. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. into the world today, and may you feel the presence of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.